This is a program that discusses issues of faith for people looking for answers. This is Viewpoint with Bob Placie.
The separation of church and state is often a quoted policy, despite the fact it really isn't in our Constitution. The courts and public policy have pulled a lot of church out of our government. But should the church stop talking about the government and politics? Walt Sheppard's a pastor, and he believes the church and politics should go together. We should be involved in the political situations in our country.
Yes, and I believe that the churches have become quite quiet. They've been silent in this
neutered
process.
Almost, yes.
Yeah, and yet you still have in Matthew chapter 5, and where it says that we're to be the salt and light of this world. Mm-hmm. And so how does someone as a Christian, a Bible believer, become salt or light when they don't do anything with the policies that are directing the culture and the decisions that are being made to legislate really what laws would be around us? And so I say Jude 3 says we're to earnestly contend for the faith. And so a lot of Christians that are sitting in churches are behind four mm-hmm. walls, and the liberal media and the liberal left is okay. If you could just stay behind your four walls, believe what you want, but just don't bring it into, here's another key word here, a couple words, is don't bring it into public arena. Yeah. Just keep what you believe to yourself, but don't tell anybody else about it.
Or you can come out as an individual, and they don't care. They'll shoot you down as an individual if you come out in the public arena, but they don't want the church. They know there's a power in the church. They don't want the church teaching or encouraging people to become involved in that, because there's statistics. You had one about the people that are involved in the election process.
Yeah. There's 80 million, and this is polls, 80 million Christians, voting age, that are in churches, and it's across the board, any Christian churches mm-hmm. across America, and they say any given election cycle, between 30 and 35 million of those 80 million Christians vote. Less than half. 40 to 45 million Christians will not vote. So that's a powerful number.
As you look at your own congregation, why would you say people are going to sit in the pews and not go to the voting booth?
I think there's several reasons. I think, one, they're not being informed by the pulpits. I think there's a fear factor in that they're afraid perhaps to say anything because of the loud voice that the small minority of our country has. But I'll say the left is quite concerned about the direction of our country going back right again. You think about all the issues that are in our day. Transgender education in 5-year-old classes over in California. That's legislation that is trying to be put through. LGBTQ movement, the same-sex marriage, abortion. You go through any issue of the day that we're dealing with, and it's exploding every day. Way before they became political issues, they were biblical issues. Mm-hmm. And so if I'm a Bible believer, and if your listeners are Bible believers, then we have a responsibility to take those Bible principles and share them in the public mm-hmm. arena and let people know what the Bible says and being salt or light in this world.
Well, what's happened is they use this statement, separation of church and state, and they also use the fear factor of you start preaching that from the pulpit, and you're going to lose your exempt tax status.
Yes.
You're going to lose your 501c3. You're no longer going to be tax exempt. And so they use that fear, and they kind of whip that over the churches to keep them out of that arena. Is that legitimate?
Well, no. We do have the fear that statement, separation of church and state, and that's being floated around. But of course, we understand it's not a constitutional statement. Jefferson, in 1881, put that in the Baptist Danbury Association. It was not even part of the Constitution.
Wall.
Yeah. What he was saying, and the spirit of what he was saying, is that he did not want the state to be in the church, but he wanted the church to influence the state. Yeah. He didn't want a state church, so we didn't want a Church of England like
we just came away from that.
Yes. He wanted to have a influence from the church to the state.
If we have a legitimate right to be involved in the political arena, we have a responsibility and mandate from the Word. Has the church stepped out, or have we been kicked out?
I think the church has stepped out. Mm-hmm. I think the fear that we've been kicked out is based on a Johnson Amendment. And I hear sometimes, you know, when I'm preaching on issues that are moral issues or political issues of our day, and I'll occasionally get someone say, Pastor, you're going to endanger our church tax exempt status if you keep it up. And of course, the Johnson Amendment is getting people so scared to say mm-hmm. anything. And this is, again, a good way to keep us quiet.
For those who don't know, tell us about the Johnson Amendment.
Johnson Amendment was put forth to be able to basically control the pulpits from endorsing candidates and having candidates be able to come in and use a platform as a platform to
to run
an office.
Right.
But boy, we've gone so far the other way. Well, we don't even speak about issues and being able to take these issues. Another interesting thought is that when God destroyed, and I believe this, I believe our country, the Bible says righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And we have exalted sin in our nation. I read the statistic this morning, 7.6 million babies that have been murdered, taken from the womb innocently, innocent blood, and some just thrown in a trash can. That's an indictment against our nation. And in 1973, when they put, Supreme Court agreed that lawfully they can do that, I believe that set us on a horrible course for the judgment of God. And I do believe that. We are under the impending judgment of God. However, I know that that's coming. But when God judges, He usually takes His people out before He judges. Case in point, when Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed, He was bringing Lot and his family out. Last time I checked, there are some very good, God-fearing men and women that are in political offices that are in Washington, D.C., and they plead with me. I go there every year, and they plead with us, and they say, please, get your people involved. This is a cesspool, and we need to hear from you. One of them said to me that every phone call that anyone makes from their district represents 1,000 people.
Powerful.
So it's powerful.
And you look at that one phone call, 1,000 people, you look at 80 million people sitting in churches, more than half of which are not voting, and you look at the power that's there to do what God's called us to do, and we're still not doing it. What can we do as a church? I mean, if your church is apparently doing some of this, what can churches do to not risk their 501c3, not risk their tax-exempt status, but at the same time, to be politically active in a biblical way?
Well, there's do's and don'ts that you can do. You can get those off a lot of different good websites. But the Christian voice needs to be made, and it needs to be heard. The pastors, if they could take, we're so busy. Pastors are very busy doing this. And a
lot
of
only work
things.
On Sunday.
Yeah, that's it. We don't work hardly at all. But if you can get a key person out of the church, if they can have someone that's inclined to politics, understands policies, and bring them up and have them do the research on these issues, and then once a week or once every 2 weeks or once a month, just kind of say, listen, this particular issue is coming up for vote. Please call your representative. Here's a number to call. Make it easy for the church. So that's number one. Number two, you can conduct voter registration. We'd be surprised how
churches
many...
Churches down south did that for years.
Absolutely. Get people in the church that are not registered to vote. Just get out there and get registered. So conduct that. It wouldn't take much to do.
Do some pastors think, well, that's a worthless operation? Everybody here votes. But with that statistic...
I know pastors.
They've got a lot of people that could register.
Right. I know pastors, good people, good men that preach this book. And when they start getting informed about the representative government that they're in right now, which is a gift of God, when they start finding that out, they said, some have admitted, said, I have not voted for 20 years of my life. I'm back in. So that's a huge shift. I think that's a blessing, actually. If you look at every major leader in the Bible, you have Elijah. He had some connection to the political leader, Ahab. Mm-hmm. Joseph had a political leader to Pharaoh. Moses had a connection to Pharaoh. Paul, Agrippa, Jonah, the king of Nineveh, on and on. You'll be hard-pressed to find a spiritual leader in the Bible that did not connect to the known government of his or her day. And you'll find that. And so I would say this, in our culture, we have for the last 40 years, we have stepped away from that arena. And that arena is affecting us, whether we like it or not, is affecting us. 7.6 million babies have been affected from a decision that the church in 1973 handed my generation, and said, here you go. Well, I would like to take to the next generation, hand them a generation that says, you know what? We overthrew Roe v. Wade. And we can do that. We can do that. I believe this present administration, if we can get the right justices in there, we can overturn Roe v. Wade. That would be a blessing.
We're talking about making your voice heard, get a church liaison that keeps up to date on the issues, conduct voter registration, and get connected to political leaders.
Even locally, I think they can get political leaders, get people in your local area, get connected, get to know them. Okay, Politicians are scared of pastors, and pastors are scared of politicians.
Well, in some cultures, the pastors become the politicians.
That's true. That's true.
We've seen that in a lot of social justice churches, where
that's
the pastor
true.
Is passionate about what he's
right.
what he's living,
right.
and he becomes a political leader.
Absolutely. Yeah. But if you can get good godly men, good godly women in government, put them together and say, listen, this is what we believe. This is what the Bible says. Mm-hmm. This, as you represent me, this is what I would want you to represent, my values. And I appreciate the wisdom that God gave our founding fathers in forming one of the most historical experiments in the history of humankind, mm-hmm. the Constitution of the United States of America. Let's use it. Let's vote. Let's get out and do what we should civilly be part of, getting the Christian vote, being salt and light in this dark world.
If you'd like more information about Jesus Christ or how to connect to a local church, go to our website or Facebook page. We have a lot more resources there that we can connect you with. Plus, I'd like to hear from you. Here's what's on the next Viewpoint.